guys, it's Rachel here.
Shh, no, don't get up.
With Sense of Tempo, Connie Corso. My dogs are bad. When I say my intro, they all get, look at this face. Look at this pumped up face. He's like, what are we doing? What are we doing, Mom? We going somewhere? No, we're not. So anyway, it's too hot, unfortunately. I'll have to wait for it to cool down before I can let the dogs out because it's just way too hot. Enzo's out here with everybody. Savannah's doing her homework, so anyway, Belladonna's putting her cage right now because she is being a butt. She's way too energetic, way too hyper, and causing problems, so she's in a bit of a timeout. And the two twins, which are not actually twins, but we call them the twins, are outside. They're going potty. And they can't, like, whenever I bring them in, I'll have to put them in their kennel, but, what's his name? Valak is going through this period where he's being like really super loud, like having this super high pitched bark and whenever he wants to get out. And so I didn't want to have to constantly be messing with him on video because he can't be out. Neither him nor Vitani can be out with Enzo right now because their prey drive is just too high and they're puppies. And so they can kind of create an energy that's unsafe for Enzo. And so they are not allowed out with Enzo. That's just the way it is. Everybody else is fine. Everybody else can be around him. It's not a problem. But they're, you know, not interested anymore. But the two other pups, they just feed off of each other energy-wise. And they just need a little bit more maturity before I can really let them out with him. And so what I've been doing is I've been keeping them kenneled right in here in the living room with having Enzo out. That way they will start to kind of get bored of Enzo and really not be so interested in him and how he's doing. But I did want to kind of talk about what it's like with Enzo here. I've had a lot of people asking, you know, and then also to go into the title of this video, which is I've had so many people asking me how the cats are doing with Enzo. Blair, unfortunately, is gone. We don't know where she is. Savannah, this door right here, it is kind of hard to close. If you don't actually make sure to push it shut, it will kind of, it'll catch. And unfortunately, Savannah just one night, she just, you know, didn't kind of check it. She's a kid, things happen. And when we woke up in the morning, the door was just open. And basically, Blair had kind of used her claws to scratch open the door and got out. Falcord didn't. He's not really an outside cat. I don't know, those of you that have cats, you know, there's two types of cats. There's cats that want to be outside and cats that don't care. Falcord doesn't care. Blair wanted nothing more than to be outside. That's all she ever cared about. Anytime you had her, that's exactly what we were dealing with. She always wanted to be outside.
It was a struggle keeping her
in. It was a struggle, yeah. I'm gonna pause this for a minute because I gotta bring those two pups in because it is hot, so give me one sec. Whew. Okay, it's so hot out there, y'all. I caught my dogs right in time. I called this company to fix the house where they were getting in. And unfortunately, they haven't come out and fixed it yet. They did come out and look, but they haven't actually gotten the material yet to fix it. I guess the hardy board that's on my house is textured to kind of look like, well, I don't even know what it's supposed to look like. And so for whatever reason, most of the places don't carry it, so I think they're probably having to have it shipped. So it's taking a while to fix it. I did get the system to do the electrical cord or electrical wire, and I'm gonna set that up today because I'm so tired of catching them. I have cinder blocks in the way, but it's not enough. And they're trying to get under there because it's cooler, you know what I mean? It's cooler, and if I don't get out there to get them in fast enough, then they want to get under there. But unfortunately, they don't just lay under there. They actually do damage to the house, so that's not cool. So yeah, thank God, caught them just in time. But as I was saying, outside cats, Blair always wanted to be an outside cat. That's all she's ever wanted. It's been a fight to keep her inside every single time. And this time, because we didn't catch it, there was really nothing we could do. And unfortunately, we have not seen her. I've been waiting to say something about it because I figured, well, maybe, you know, we'll catch her. We did put out, we tried to do the same thing we did last time. We tried to put out a trap with some food in it to get her interested. And unfortunately, we have not seen her at all. Like, not a glimpse of this cat. And last time we would see her all the time. She'd be prowling about. I mean, I have my chickens outside. I really do think that if she was out there, that we would have seen some sign of her, and there's been no sign. And I'm just thinking that something basically picked her up. Either a bird, like a predatory bird, or a coyote.
Person. She's not a person bird, or a person dog.
Yeah, and like, and like, yeah, there's no way a person got her. Like, she's a very, like, a skittish kind of cat. She loves me, she loves Savannah, but that's it. And so I know that nobody just has her in the house. That's not what happened. You know, she's probably gone. So unfortunately, that's just where we're at. So in regards to Blair and Enzo, you know, obviously she's not here. So we had a lot of people speculating about the time that she had spent outdoors and that it would make her more prone to wanting to kind of get him. And I have no doubt that it absolutely would have done that. But my thing is that, you know, you can always redirect behaviors, even with cats. You know what I'm saying? Falcor, on the other hand, he pretty much minds, you know, he was...
runs away whenever he sees the bird.
Yeah, he was interested at first. So what I did with Falcor, and he's like probably laying around being fat somewhere because that's what he does. But what I did to kind of to basically make sure that he didn't really pay any mind to the cat or to the bird is every time that he would look at Enzo, I would do the sound that I'm not going to do right now because all the dogs are going to get up and run. But as the sound that I've shown you guys before, it's a hissing sound. Yeah, it's a hissing sound that I make whenever my cats are doing something that I don't want them to do. Yeah. And then he would run because he knows that the dogs are coming. And I don't, it's not like I choose to like set my dogs after the cat to like attack the cat. They would never attack the cat. The original reason why I taught my dogs to do that was because Blair would always try to escape. And so what I would do is I would have Preacher specifically is actually the dog that I taught to do this. I used to live in a house with a roommate and you know, as you guys know, when you have a roommate, nobody cares about your animals the way that you do. And so I wouldn't let Blair out of my room because people would let her out. And it was a very dangerous situation because we lived in a subdivision and very fast driving cars all the time. And I didn't want her to get out and get hit or something like that. So the minute she would try to get out, I would have Preacher, I would make that sound, and Preacher would run and basically just chase her off. And even if he did, like if she did get out, he would herd her literally back up to the house. And I've done videos on this before to show that he would never hurt her. He would put her in a corner and then literally look at me, and he wouldn't let her out of the corner, and I would grab her and put her up. So really demonstrating that these dogs, there is a history of using them for herding purposes. I'm not saying that it's their predominant thing, but they absolutely can and will do it, and they won't actually hurt the animal. So I can do that sound, and my cats know, you know, get out of whatever it is that they were into, get away from it. And so basically, every time I'd do that sound, he would run and hide. And I actually learned that from my family, because our family, anytime our cats were doing something we didn't want, we would hiss at them. And it had nothing to do with the dogs. The cats just kind of, it's a universal sound. They just know to stay away from that sound. And so it was like a non-issue for us. So like I said, we've not seen Blair at all. Like I said, I waited to kind of do this video because I thought, well, maybe we would find her, but it's pretty obvious that we're not. If that changes, I'll let y'all know. But like I said, the last time, even though she was out, we had lots of sightings of her, and we've just not seen her at all. And other than that, like I said, Falcor's fine. He really could care less. All the other dogs are fine. They could care less. These two guys here, for the most part, are getting better. They're getting more adjusted to having the cat here and kind of being like whatever about it. There's always going to be... Oh, sorry. Yeah, the Enzo, the bird. Sorry. I have too many animals and I'm forgetting what to call them all. So that's kind of where we're at. Everybody is pretty much ignoring him. In fact, Enzo was like walking around on Blondie's back earlier. He was walking on Mad Mortigan and with our supervision, obviously, and it was fine. So I think they're pretty much over it. These guys are getting better. They're not 100% there yet. Like I said, if I had them, like they're getting to where they'll ignore him when they're in their kennel. But if they were out and he did something to kind of trigger that prey drive in them, like maybe he flew down to the floor, which he's been known to do, then that would probably really get them engaged in a way that would be unhealthy. And so I just don't want to let them out until I don't see their attention get amped up in an unhealthy way, no matter what it is that he's doing. All the rest of my dogs, Enzo can fly to the floor and they know, because I tell them, I'll let him fly to the floor and I will tell them, I'll watch them and I let them know, don't you touch my bird. And they all just, they're like, oh God. And they just look away. You know what I mean? So they know it's mine. It's no different than if it was my toy. You know what I'm saying? It's mine. You don't touch it. And they just kind of know that. He is so cute. Look at him being so cute, y'all. He's getting all the love right now.
My bunny's still alive. Well, not my bunny.
Dude, nobody knows about your bunny.
Dude,
I haven't made a
live stream, but not really.
Okay, but I'm gonna do a video about it, so nobody really knows. I'll tell y'all about the bunny, in a different video. I didn't want it to be like overload of information, like way too much stuff going on at once. But anyway, but that's just kind of where we're at. That's just the update on Enzo and the update on Blair. It is a sad day for us. Well, it's been sad, not just a sad day, but it's a sad day to even make this video. I've been not wanting to make this video. But on the flip side, you know, like, I'm going to tie this into something that maybe some people may not agree with, whatever. I don't care. It's my opinion, my experience, my life. There's a lot of people, like, for example, here in Austin, they have a catch and release program for stray cats because of the fact that cats can survive on their own. They're not like dogs. Cats can be out in the wild and, you know, especially like in suburban areas, and they can survive and they can be fine. And so the city will catch the cats. They'll spay and neuter the cats. They'll give them vaccinations and then they'll re-release them back where they were. And they're good for rodent control and things like that. And, you know, and that's fine. Having said that, if you went to a rescue around here and you told them, hey, I'd like to rescue a cat, and they ask you, well, you know, is your cat going to be an outside cat, inside cat? If you tell them your cat's going to be an outside cat, they will not let you adopt a cat because they see that as being unhealthy. And that's because on average, cats that live outdoors have a shorter lifespan. When they live inside, they have a longer lifespan. And that's because of the fact that there are less dangers in the house than there are outside of the house. So it's considered good cat ownership to prolong your cat's life by keeping them inside, regardless of the fact that your cat may in fact want to be outside and may actually be much happier outside, okay? And you're talking to somebody who kept their cat inside, knowing that. I had a cat that desperately wanted to be outside, and she still eventually got outside, and, you know, and now she's gone, right? And so it's an unfortunate reality. And I've had a lot of people who have criticized me for having Enzo's wings clipped. And there's a lot of people that believe that you should let a bird fly. And I kind of see it the same way. There are, first of all, a cat is much better adapted to living here where we live than even Enzo would be. Enzo is not at all, they can't even fly well enough. If you ever watch like Bird Tricks, you'll see that they have very specific places that they fly their gray because their flight isn't as, they're just not as, not that they're not good flyers, but they are not as good of flyers as other birds are. And if you look at the natural way that these birds live, they actually spend quite a lot of time on the ground. They scurry kind of up and down trees, and then they'll kind of like hang out before they actually hit the ground looking for predators, and then they'll forage on the ground. So they aren't even as much of flyers as, say, like maybe a macaw would be. And having said that, the way that these birds live is they live in massive groups, and so there's lots of eyes looking around for predators. Enzo obviously does not have that, on top of the fact he's in an environment that is completely unnatural to him. And so the way that I see it is, if it's neglectful and bad ownership to let a cat get out, how is it also not bad ownership to let a parrot get out? Especially when the parrot is even more likely to be injured by being outside than even the cat would be. You know what I'm saying? And there are people that believe that, well, the bird wants to fly. Well, the cat wants to be outside. But you don't always get what you want when it's not safe, right? Like, there are children that want to do things that we don't let them do because it's not, you know, yeah, it's not safe. And so the same thing with Enzo. It's not safe for him outside. Therefore, he's not allowed. And I also think that there's a lot of issues where people are basically like, they have an emotion, and so they're putting that emotion onto the bird, even though the bird itself doesn't have that emotion. So for example, people are like, well, how would you feel if you couldn't fly? Well, I ask, or if you were a bird and you couldn't fly, well, I would like you to go outside and ask my chickens how they feel about that, because my chickens can't fly either. They can fly just as much as Enzo can. And so they're fine. You know what I mean? Like, they're not depressed and sad. They don't know that they are chickens. There's plenty of documentaries and stuff on animals that don't realize that they are what they are if they're raised around other species. There's even like a I think it's a bonobo that was like that as well. Like, he's like a white bonobo I watched a documentary on. And there have been like wildebeest that were hanging out with zebras. Like, there's been all kinds of weird issues like that where there were animals that weren't raised around their own kind, so they don't know how to act like their own kind because they don't know what they are. And so I don't subscribe to the idea that Enzo is suffering because he's not able to fly around. The way that I see it is, if you had never ridden on a roller coaster, you're not going to suffer and be in misery because you've never gotten to ride a roller coaster. You know what I mean? Like, if you go and you ride a roller coaster and you love it, you absolutely love it, and then someone tells you you can never ride a roller coaster again, you know what I mean? Like, that would definitely be suffering, but Enzo has not had that. So that's the difference. On top of that, he does still fly around my house. You know what I mean? Like, he, you know, fly glides, I will say. You know what I mean? It's like a half-half. Yeah, he has no problem trying to use his wings. You know what I mean? Like, so the idea that somehow his wings are going to atrophy and fall off, no, they're not. Like, he does still use them around the house. And this is just what's safest for him. Now, whether or not that is fair to any animal to keep them in captivity is an entirely separate issue. Obviously this isn't a channel for it, because obviously I raise pets, to be in homes, and I also crop and dock. So I'm not sure why people think that I would be so against wing clipping. Whenever wing clipping, there's literally no nerve endings there. It causes them absolutely no pain. Now, granted, what we do is done by a surgeon, and therefore they don't have any pain either, but regardless, there is pain afterwards, obviously, and we do put them on pain management. But still, having said that, we are going to do things that we feel are in our animal's best interest. You know why I crop and dock, and that's obviously going to be why I'm going to clip wings. There is a small minority of people that believe that wing clipping is cruel and suffering and blah, 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 blah. It's not the vast majority. I've done research on this. There's a woman whose parrot got lost in England. She was always free flighting her bird, and then she missed a week and then took her bird out. Her bird literally took off and was like, I'm out of here. It took her, I think, a little over a day to get the bird back. And they interviewed this guy who teaches free flight to people. And he said that he talks more people out of free flight than he even talks into it, because he said it's such a commitment. Because once birds start to free fly, it is suffering if you don't let them out. Like you, he says you have to dedicate at least 2 hours a day. And if you can't do that, if you can't make that commitment, then it's not fair to the bird to even do it in the first place. So, and they will have mental anguish. They will have behaviors where they act out and they get mad and they pluck and they this and this and that. So I wish that there was a more reasonable crowd of people on the internet, or at least on YouTube, about this, because it just seems like there's not. Hold on. I had a lot of people calling me today. But I'm not going to bend to the pressure. You guys know me. That's not how I roll. I'm going to do what I believe is in my animal's best interest. And I don't believe that letting Enzo free fly, in my area is in his best interest. So that's that. Just wanted to kind of cover that and kind of like expand upon it and really try to introduce some logic into it, because there's a lot of people with a lot of emotions and they don't care. It's like, so what if the bird dies? At least he got these moments of freedom. And I'm sorry, but if you're not willing to apply that to everything else in life, then it makes no sense. That's not the way that things work. And the people that are saying this, some of them have never even had a bird. They're just repeating what they've heard other people say because they believe that that's the narrative now. That's the thing that we say, which is just ridiculous. And it's kind of like the whole spay and neuter thing. Everybody needs a spay and neuter. Everybody believed in it. Everybody preaches it. And now we find out that it's horrible for the dogs. And it's like, it's the same thing. It's like, for whatever reason, we as a species, we do this thing where we hear an idea, everybody thinks it's good, and then whether it is or not, nobody looks into it. They just all just, you know, no pun intended, but they parrot it. You know what I mean? They all just repeat it, and they push the narrative regardless of whether or not it's actually true or not, or whatever. So anyway, so I'm done talking about this. I'm gonna let y'all go. I gotta call people back and I have to get ready because I have to take Velocity in for an x-ray. So hope you guys are having a good day, and I'll talk at you later. Bye.